بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. وقال تعالى أيضا، فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره، ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa, that is to bring in the consciousness of our beloved maker Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can a believer attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, before we delve into the topic of today's khutbah, I would like to ask you all a hypothetical question. A question to which I'm not expecting an answer. You can answer it within your minds. The question is, if each and every one of your bank accounts were credited every single day with $86,400 every single day, that amounts to almost around 9 million Sri Lankan rupees. $86,400 every single day. Only condition is, by the time it becomes evening, by the time you go to rest, this $86,400, whether you spend it or not, is going to go zero, and the next day morning when you wake up, a fresh $86,400 is going to be credited to your account. What would each and every one of us do with that $86,400? Will we not utilize it to the maximum every single day? Will we not rush to the banks to withdraw it before it is deleted from our accounts? Every single day. This parable, this example is given to time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Every single day, Allah the Almighty credits our accounts with 86,400 seconds. 86,400 seconds every single day. But are we utilizing it to the maximum? Every single one of us, we have a hypothetical sand glass in front of us. What is a sand glass? Opposing an hourglass. An hourglass is something, an instrument used to measure an hour. You have two bulbs with two glass bulbs with sand running in it to measure an hour. But a sand glass, it measures not only an hour, perhaps 10 hours, perhaps one whole day if the sand glass is big enough. All of us, we have our sand glasses in front of us. We can see the past that has gone by, but we cannot see how much more sand is remaining, how much more time we have got. But rather we can only see the trickling sand right in the middle through the narrow passage in the sand glass. That is the present. That is the present. We can see the past. We can see what has already gone by us. We can't do anything about it. We can't change anything in our past. But as for the future, we don't know how much time we have left. It could be perhaps an hour more, or perhaps a year more, or perhaps even decades more. But the question is, are we going to utilize every single second to the maximum? Our Salafun al-Salih, like Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he says that, O son of Adam, you are nothing but a couple of days. O son of Adam, I repeat, O son of Adam, you are nothing but a couple of days. With each and every passing day, a part of you also vanishes away. Say you are supposed to live in this dunya, on the face of this earth, for 60 years. With every single day, it is minus 60. Gradually you become 50, 40, 30, 20, 10, and then we leave this world. Likewise, Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, in regard to the value of time, إضاعة الوقت أشد من الموت. Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, profound words. These words need to be inscribed in gold. He says that wasting time that Allah the Almighty has given us, it is worse than death. إضاعة الوقت أشد من الموت. Wasting of time is worse than death. The reason being, لأن إضاعة الوقت تقطعك عن الله والدار الآخرة. Because wasting of time cuts you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from you involving yourself in things that please our beloved maker, and likewise it cuts you away from al-akhirah. But as for mouth, death only cuts you away from dunya and cuts you away from the people of dunya. But wasting of time cuts you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the akhirah which we are headed to. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, now moving on to the topic of today's khutbah. Just as the genius Umar radiallahu anhu says, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Take account of yourselves before you are taken into account. In other words, audit your books before your books will be audited. The topic for today's khutbah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is Muhasabatun Nafs. From these valuable moments, from the seconds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, take a moment from those valuable moments to take account of yourself before you are taken to account. Just as how Umar radiallahu anhu says. And Allah the Almighty, He says in the Noble Quran, the ayat I recited in the beginning, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. The one who does even an atom's weight, مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ, even an atom's weight of good shall indeed see it on the Day of Judgment. Likewise, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. As for the one who does even an atom's weight of evil, he will also see it on the Day of Judgment. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this life of dunya that Allah the Almighty has given us is not something that we are supposed to attach ourselves onto. It is not something that we are supposed to latch ourselves onto. Temporary, transitory stage, we are crossing through it. Just a matter of 50, 60, 70 years. Our destination is al-akhirah. We are just crossing through this stage. There is no point in amassing millions and building palaces, even though it is not haram. But the point is, have we made secure investments that will benefit us in the akhirah, that will benefit us in our eternal permanent destination? Luqman al-Hakim alayhi salatu wasalam, he advises his son, oh my dear son, along the lines of these words, from the day you were born, you are gradually getting closer to your destination, which is al-akhirah. From the day you were born, every single day that passes by drags you closer to al-akhirah and makes you get further from al-dunya. This is the life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. One of our salafun al-salih, I can't recall his name, he once sat down and thought of making muhasabatun nafs. He thought of taking account of himself. He sat down. He was 60 years old. he starts counting the days that have passed by, he realizes or he determines that 21,900 days of his life has passed away. Now he thinks, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, 21,900 days. If I am to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with just 21,900 days, out of which say even, at a minimum, if I had sinned 10 sins a day, I meet Allah the Almighty with 219,000 sins. Have I done, have I taken account of myself to equal that with good deeds, or surpass that with good deeds, to be successful in al-akhirah? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to taking account of ourselves, it's just not some fancy statement or some fancy title for a scholar to get up on the minbar and just advise in regard to it, or for a sheikh from the mashayikh to sit in the masajid and discuss about. But rather, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is a methodology, muhasabatun nafs. It is a methodology which entails a few techniques that we have to master and adopt in our lives. Each and every one of us, we need to take account of ourselves. And when I say a few techniques, this is according to the teachings of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah and his students. He says that number one, the first comparison or the first technique that has to be entailed in Al-Muhasabatul Nafs is Al-Muqayasatu Bayna Ni'ami Wal-Jinaya. Please follow. Very important words of Imam Al-Qayyim rahimahullah. Al-Muqayasatu Bayna Ni'ami Wal-Jinaya. He says that it is very important that we strike a comparison between the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which has been conferred upon us, and likewise the transgressions, the vice that we are involved in. Only if we sit down and compare this, we'll understand that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are so great, and we are ungrateful slaves. After being blessed with so much of blessings, we still involve ourselves in sin and transgression. Even if we were to take the different blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are basically wallowing in an ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I do not wish to go deep into that particular aspect, but even if we were to take our hearts, this organ that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, this organ, the vascular system that takes the blood, this blood that we need to survive all around our body, is 60,000 miles in length. This vascular system can cover the circumference of the earth twice, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. This organ that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, it beats 100,000 times a day. It beats 100,000 times a day. It pumps 2 gallons of blood per minute. Per minute it pumps 2 gallons of blood. 100 gallons of blood per hour. 100 gallons of blood. It does not take a leave. It does not take a break. It works 365 days, 24/7, until Allah the Almighty commands it to stop beating. This, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is just one blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What about the other blessings? Allah has given us health, Allah has given us time, Allah has given us good limbs, all of which, even if we were to stay in sajda, if we were to fall in sajda, prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for our whole life, it would not suffice as gratitude shown to Allah the Almighty, our powerful and beloved maker. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the scholars, they say why it is so important for us to have this comparison, to compare between what Allah the Almighty has blessed us with, is because there is a scary reality to it. The hadith of Uqbat ibn Amir, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and please remember salawat, whenever I mention his beautiful name, is reported to have said, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ اللَّهَ إِذَا رَأَيْتَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُعْتِ الْعَبْدَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا مَا يُحِبْ. If you see an individual being blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all that he wishes, the hadith goes along the lines of these words, with all that he wishes, And if he's still involved in sins, فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ السِّدْرَاجِ. Know that this is one of the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala known as istidraj. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then goes on to recite the ayah.
فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying that if you see a slave of Allah being blessed with whatever he wishes whilst he is committing transgressions, whilst he is in vice and sin, know that this is istidraj, one of the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah goes on, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to recite the words of our beloved maker, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ. When they, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they forget that which they are being reminded, فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We shall open the doors of all blessings for them. They will live a life of luxury. They will have every single thing that they wish. حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا. Until they become happy, until they become comfortable with their lives. أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً. And then suddenly we shall seize them. Allahu Akbar. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. And then they will be in utter despair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, another aspect which we will be quickly touching on is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses one of us, how do we identify between that blessing being a ni'mah or a fitna from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We'll try to touch that as we go. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the next technique which is entailed in muhasabatun nafs, taking account of yourself, is al-muqayasatu bayna al-hasanati wa-sayyi'at. Al-muqayasatu bayna al-hasanati wa-sayyi'at. And that is to compare between your evil deeds and your good deeds, between the sins that you have committed and the good deeds that you are committing. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he attaches three conditions to this comparison. How do you compare your evil deeds with your good deeds? Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, the first condition that has to be fulfilled for you to be able to master al-muhasabatun nafs is Nurul Hikmah. Allahu Akbar. Nurul Hikmah. In other words, Nurul Ilm. In no way will we be able to differentiate between good deeds and evil deeds without knowledge. Knowledge is important. It is compulsory on every single Muslim. We live in a time and an era where it is so easy for us to seek knowledge. You can go online. There are so many videos. There are so many books. Everything is within your fingertips. No one can give us an excuse today that they don't have time, or they don't have resources, or that they don't have sources to seek knowledge from. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to seek the proper knowledge. In regard to this condition, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is important for us to know the Arkan Salah, the pillars of Salah. It is important for us to know how to make Salah. It is important for us to know the mubtilatu salah, those factors that nullify your salah, that nullify your ablution. How are you to fast Ramadan? How are you to make hajj or umrah? Or if you're going to get married, what are the conditions of nikah? Likewise, in regard to business, all of us are involved in business in some way or the other. What are the conditions? What are those things that are haram? All of this, seeking this knowledge, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is of utmost importance. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says that an individual has to attach to seeking knowledge so much importance that even more than the importance he attaches to food, water and drink. Without food and water, he says, what is the worst that could happen? You could die. But without knowledge, you end up in Jahannam. Without knowledge, you don't know how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't know how to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So condition number one is to give dire necessity, in other words, to give dire importance to seeking knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Noble Quran, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. Look at this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, know أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Him. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, and seek forgiveness. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, for your evil deeds. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he says that the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about this ayah, فَعْلَمْ, in other words, priority is given to knowledge. First seek knowledge and then do amal. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, seek forgiveness. Priority is given to ilm over amal. The reason being, only if ilm is sought, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, can our amal become perfect in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Salafun as-Salih, they are reported to have said, the ones who are ignorant, the juhal, the jahilun, the ones who do not have knowledge, the ones who are ignorant, they face death before they face the real death. In other words, it is death. Without knowledge, you are considered dead. And their bodies become graves before they are put into their real graves. Allahu Akbar. The juhal, they face death before real death. And likewise, their bodies become graves before they are put into their real graves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the pure knowledge. The second condition, التمييزُ بين النعمة والفتنة. I touched on this in the beginning. To differentiate between what is a ni'mah and what is a fitna. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ fitna. Look at the ayah. Your children and your wealth are a fitna. What is a fitna? A fitna, a trial, a test, a calamity. How can our wealth, how can our families, how can our children be trials and tests? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, today we look at ourselves, we have so much of money. We are living in the laps of luxury. We have wealth. We have good families, good spouses, good children. All of these things, how do we identify whether it is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Each and every single thing that brings us closer to our beloved Maker, that wealth which we earn, if it brings us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, makes us involved in good deeds, in charitable deeds, brings us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then of course it is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But on the other hand, if we become money machines, if we become workaholics, we don't have time for salah, we don't have time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only priority is given to making more and more and more money, then my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that wealth is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty is testing us. It is a test to see whether we pass it with flying colors to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. The final condition, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, سُوءُ الظَّنْ بِالنَّفْسِ. All of us, we think of ourselves as, oh, I am so and so. I have so much of money. Or I am in the seat of power. I have authority. Or I am so and so a scholar. I am this, I am that. I am so educated. I am a graduate from this university and from that university. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty says in the Noble Quran, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ تؤتي الملك من تشاء وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. Allah the Almighty, in His hands, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is kingdom and power. He gives power and authority to whom He wishes, and He plucks it away from whom He wishes. He gives honor and dignity to whosoever He wishes, and likewise He takes it away from whom He wishes. Allah the Almighty, Malikul Mulk, He is the King of all kings. To Him belongs all power and all might.
Nothing is ours, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Look at the story of Harun al-Rashid, rahimahullah. A king, a powerful king, at his deathbed, one of his wishes was that he wanted to go have a look at his qabr. He wanted to go have a look at his qabr. The courtiers, his family members who were around him, they were amazed and they were worried. Why is he wishing to go and see his qabr? But he said, that's my wish. I want to go see my qabr. I want to go see my final resting place. So they take him, they carry him. He's at the throes of death. They carry him to his qabr. The minute he sees that dark pit, the king, he is the king, living in the laps of luxury. Whatever he wishes, he gets. So much of money, so much of wealth, power, authority. The minute he sees that dark hole that he is about to enter, he cries out, مَا أَغْنَى عَنِّي مَهَلِيًا أَلَكَ عَنِّي سُلْطَانِيًا. He cries out, Ya Allah, مَا أَغْنَى عَنِّي مَهَلِيًا. My wealth, all of this wealth has not availed me or has not benefited me. هَلَكَ عَنِّي سُلْطَانِيًا. My seat, my power, my authority, everything has been destroyed from me. And then he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya man la yazulu mulkum, ya man la yazulu mulkum, ya man la yazulu mulkum. Oh, the one to whom all of these kingdoms belong to, the one whom his kingdom will never ever perish. إِرْحَمْ مَنْ قَدْ زَالَ مُلْكُمْ إِرْحَمْ مَنْ قَدْ زَالَ مُلْكُمْ إِرْحَمْ مَنْ قَدْ زَالَ مُلْكُمْ. Have mercy upon the one whose kingdom has been destroyed. Have mercy upon the one whose kingdom has been destroyed. Have mercy upon the kingdom, upon the one whose kingdom has been destroyed. Allahu Akbar. This is the reality of life, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Finally, I leave you all with a hadith, which is known as the Hadith al-Bitaqa. This hadith is narrated by Imam Hakim in his Mustadrak. It is known as the Hadith of the card. It is known as the Hadith of the card. The hadith goes along the lines of these words. On the day of Qiyamah, and it is not a fairy tale, it is not from my pocket, it is sahih, it is authentic according to the conditions of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, on the day of Qiyamah, on the day of Qiyamah, a man will be called up. He will be called and brought forward. And when this man is brought forward, 90 odd registers, 90 odd books will be spread out in front of him. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, حَسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Our books are being recorded. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Haqqa, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِشِمَالِهِ فَيَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أُوْتَ كِتَابِيَهِ. As for the one who gets his book of records in his left hand, he say, woe be unto me, ya laytani lam uta kitabiya. Woe be unto me, how I wish that this book was not given to me. But as for the one who will get his book in his right hand, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيًا. As for the one who gets his book of records in his right hand, he will go around crying out, all of you all read my book, here is my book, I am successful on this day. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, coming back to the hadith, a man will be brought on the day of Qiyamah, 90 odd registers will be pulled out in front of him. All of his registers, all of his accounts will be pulled out. All will contain his transgressions, his crimes and his sins. Allahu Akbar. The man will be dejected. The man will be dejected. 99 registers. And the hadith goes to the extent that each register will be so long
will be so long that it will be to the extent that your eyesight reaches Allahu Akbar, each register. Now it will be asked by that man, do you deny anything that has been recorded in these registers? To which he will very humbly say, no, Ya Rabb, no Allah, I do not reject anything that has been recorded in these books. And then you know what will happen. Allah the Almighty will command for one card, one tiny card to be brought up. Now this man, he will look amazed. 99 registers with so much of sins spread out in this corner. And he is in front of the mizan. And now what happens? A tiny card, a card will be brought. The man will look at the card. What is this card? On it will be written, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. The testimony of faith. This is all that will be written on this card. The man will say in amazement, Ya Allah, is this fair? Along the lines of these words, is this fair? A tiny card against 90 odd registers of sin. Allah the Almighty will say, on this day no oppression will be done unto you, O my slave. No oppression. All of these 90 odd registers will be put onto one side of the scale. And this card bearing the testimony of faith, will be put on the other side of the scale. And you know what will happen? The 90 odd registers will go flying. The Shahada will be much more heavier than all of those books, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. The point I'm trying to highlight is that the blessing of Tawheed, the blessing of Deen, the blessing of Islam, that we are born in the fold of Islam, or that Allah the Almighty has guided us to truth, that is much greater in terms as a blessing than our limbs, our hearts and all of this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. The fact that we have uttered the kalima, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the biggest and greatest blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. And no doubt we have to live according to that kalima. We have to bring in the a'mal that are obligatory, which are linked to that kalima, so that we be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. And don't be negligent of yourselves, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Keep taking account of yourselves, because we do not know upon whom Malakul Maut is waiting to meet. Malakul Maut is waiting to meet all of us at a given time. We are supposed to leave this dunya at a given time. It can be in a minute, it can be in an hour, it can be in a day, it can be in a year. All of us have to face the inevitable reality of death. So prepare for it, prepare to meet your maker, prepare and be ready so that you'll be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may He accept all of our good deeds, and may He unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah. Wa akhir da'wa, alhamdulillah.